It's time to go into business for yourself. Get ready for another episode of the Franchise Academy Podcast. Education, insight, and inspiration. Here's your host, small business and franchise expert, Tom Scarda.
Welcome to another episode of the Franchise Academy. And this is a place to come to learn about franchising. Everything you ever wanted to know about franchising, from buying a franchise to selling a franchise, anything you need for resources, that's what we're here for. And I am Tom Scarda. I'm the host. And if you haven't listened to this franchise podcast before, I'm a consultant during the day. I help people find the right franchise, figure out if franchising is right for them, because it's not for everyone. So I helped people figure out the details. I've owned and operated franchises in my past, really successful in my first franchise, and I failed miserably in my second franchise. That's what made me a franchise expert. I wrote the book Franchise Savvy based on that, and that's the little poster behind me. So pick that up on Amazon. Today I am honored, excited. I don't have enough words to have Angela Cote with me. Angela was born into franchising. Just about when she was born, her parents were in a franchise in British Columbia, Canada. So Angela now helps franchisors optimize relationships with franchisees, and it results in higher profitability and improved franchise company growth. Her expertise comes from having grown up immersed in the franchise company. Her family founded M&M Food Market, which she helped to grow to almost 500 locations, as well as 18 years as a multi-unit franchisee. So, Angela, welcome to the Franchise Academy.
Thank you. I'm super excited to be here, Tom, and finally get to do this with you.
Yeah, we've been trying to get this on for months, trying to coordinate schedules. So I'm glad that we're here, and this is so great. So you were born into franchising. What's that deal all about?
Yeah, well, I guess I wasn't exactly born into it, but I was born into it in that it was in my family. I was 5 years old when my dad founded the company. And so, yeah, whether I liked it or not over the years, just lived and breathed and learned so much about franchising. I had to dress up as Kelly Kebab as a kid at grand openings. I was the company mascot. And so thank goodness the costume covered the whole face. Otherwise I probably, you know, would have had no friends because I was embarrassed. But everything from running around at grand openings as Kelly Kebab to getting the opportunity to work alongside the franchisees that were coming in for training in our corporate centers. I then went out into the field and spent a lot of time working with getting franchises up and running, teaching the franchisees, helping train their staff initially, and then going back and working with them on their business planning and helping them with their profitability. You can only imagine what it was like to be a 20-year-old female boss's daughter showing up to try to teach these older male franchisees how to run their business.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so I definitely got hit with a lot of adversity and, like, you know, learned very quickly what doesn't work, and then, you know, eventually kind of figured out what does work in franchise relations. Spent a few years doing that, opening stores, you know, all that field work, and then I became a multi-unit operator myself, so I switched from the franchisor side of the relationship to becoming a franchisee and opened 3 stores and ran those for 18 years as a multi-unit franchisee. So that's when you say born into franchising, like kind of live and breathe, you know, the whole gamut of different things.
Right. I cannot say that I have met anyone that has been in franchising as long as you have. I mean, I know you're about 25 now,
but
20 years. I mean, you know, since you're a kid.
Yeah, there you go. 20 years. We won't do any actual math right now. Right.
We'll skip math for now.
Yeah, that sounds good.
So, you know, you were successful as a franchisee for 18 years, and now you have something called the Franchise Growth Catalyst. And it's just kind of a consulting agency to help people. So what advice do you have for franchise owners that are trying to get to the next level in their franchise?
Yeah. So as far as like franchisees advice?
franchisees' advice or franchisors that are growing, or let's do both.
Okay, let's do both. Yeah, since I kind of know a little bit about both, I guess. I think let's start with the franchisees. I think the number one thing that I experienced as a franchisee and also see a lot in the work that I do now for the past 5 years working with franchisors and with their franchisees trying to help improve profitability. The biggest thing I see is that people forget that they need to do like the hustle. You know, they need to get people in the door in a franchise. And as a franchisee, even in my family brand, which became an iconic Canadian brand that everybody knows, just because people knew the brand didn't mean we could just sit inside our store and wait for business to come in. Mm-hmm. So if we wanted to take things to the next level, it required us to get creative and do what we could in the community. And that's another thing that I see missed a lot in franchising is that franchisees, either themselves or the franchisor, forgets that that's a big part of why the franchising model works, is that local owner, right? In that community that can go out and build relationships and you know, build up the brand and the community itself. So I think for franchisees, if they're looking to do that, it's that. And then same probably for franchisors to help their franchisees get creative with how they can grow in their communities. And I always say, don't try to tell a franchisee to do something they're never going to do. If they are not comfortable going networking, then they're not going to do well at it if you do force them to do it, right? So, or they're just not going to do it. So find the things that you as a franchisee, or if you're a franchisor, find the thing your franchisee gets excited about doing, and then focus on doing those things to grow the business. So those are some things I would do to take things to the next level. It doesn't sound like rocket science, does it, Tom?
No, it's really not. And you boil it down to follow the system.
Yeah.
And just to reiterate what you said, my friend Melissa Lewis, who's a franchise consultant with Franchoice, she's a franchisologist. And she said to me the other day, when we match people with franchise opportunities, it's like helping somebody find a perfect pair of jeans. They accent the right parts and they hide the parts you don't like. So, yeah. You know, so you want to find franchisees that have the skill set that you need, right? If you have a wallflower and your franchise really requires you to be part of the community networking, you probably shouldn't grant that person a franchise.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is the kind of bigness misnomer for people when they're trying to choose a franchise.
Exactly. If I could just jump in there, I see people are afraid to talk about the realities. A franchisor is often, I don't know if afraid is the right word, but they just want to make the sale sometimes. And I always say when I'm involved in a call where if I'm with the franchisor on a call talking to a candidate, that, you know, it's only a win-win if we get this right. It's not going to work for anybody if they need to have that hustle and they don't have that hustle to go build business. And most franchises that I've ever seen do require some level of community type, you know, business growth. Like they might not have to go to a networking chamber of commerce event, but some reaching out of, you know, to get people aware of your business.
But also while we're at it, I want to talk a little bit about the International Franchise Association's mantra that franchise owners are people from your community. So they're small businesses too. So as we're thinking about COVID-19 right now, we're going through the great pandemic of 2020.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully it'll be the last one we'll see in our lifetime. You know, we're pushing to shop local. And I totally agree, but you need to realize that a franchise is local business. They pay their taxes in your county. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I just want to make that point. I think it's an important point to make right now.
Oh, it's such an important point. I actually wrote an article about how in Canada we have Tim Hortons. I think you've maybe heard of it. It's one of another iconic brand. And I believe also in the US now as well and worldwide. But I wrote an article when I first started my consulting work that I said, you know, Tim Hortons is a franchise and Starbucks is not. People automatically see a chain and they assume it's a corporate chain, right? So as franchisees, it's so important to I believe we always taught our staff to understand that I'm the owner of this business and I live and breathe in this community and I contribute to the economy. And so I try to help them even actually voice that to consumers when they had the right opportunity so that it made people feel good about shopping at a company. And actually, you'll probably get a kick out of this. People actually thought that we were an American company because it was so well done. So people would be like, oh, is this some American chain? You know, these Canadians. And I was like, no, it's Canadian owned and operated and it's franchises. So there's local owners in the local community. So yeah, I've lived and breathed that for 18 years where I was a local business owner. And even our local, there's those associations like Think Local Victoria where I live. They didn't love when franchises came in because they didn't realize to the extent that we are local owners. So I had to kind of educate on that.
It's interesting. Yeah, it's important. I think it's important for people like us to continue to remind people about that. Mm-hmm. It's such a big misnomer. And you know, I had recently somebody, a family member of mine, just stopped in some, I don't even remember what it was, some fast food place. You know, like, oh, I'm excited. I got, you know, whatever burgers. And I was like, thank you for shopping your local franchise.
Yeah. It's supporting the franchise industry, which is all, you know, these small business owners. It's fantastic.
Yeah, it's great. It's a gateway into controlling your own destiny,
mm-hmm.
which is something that you have done in your career as a franchise owner.
Yeah. So
how do you make that transition? Because it's tough to leave. Yeah. What you know to do something different.
Yeah. Now in my case, it's, you know, it's a little interesting because I grew up in, you know, on the corporate side and always thought that I would, maybe people would say, are you going to take over the company someday? And of course that was always on my mind. But at one point in my, during my, while I was in university, I can't, which we, you guys call college mostly, but same idea. I moved out west for a summer and ended up, you know, falling in love with the West, met my future husband, all these things, didn't end up going back home. So that idea of taking over the company was off the table. But when the opportunity came to become a franchisee, I, you know, it was a big step for sure. But for me, it was a little different because I already knew the brand and the company and I'd been training people. For me, the taking control of my destiny was actually on sort of the tail end of that. And why I'm telling this now is hopefully the audience that are listening, whether or not there's somebody that's looking at becoming a franchisee of a brand or they're, you know, in their corporate job, they're unhappy or they've been furloughed right now or whatever that is. Or maybe it's somebody that is in a higher level corporate position, but they're just not happy. And I realized at one point that I was ready for something new. And you can imagine why, because I grew up, you know, from the age of five, living and breathing the company brand. I did a few jobs separate from the company to get a little experience. But I think one of the biggest, you know, pivotal moments for me was when I realized, even because I think I was like 38 years old and thinking, I felt like, oh, I'm just, believe it or not, I felt like I'm just a mom. I'm just a franchisee of a brand my dad started. So I actually went and got a little bit of support. I had a career coach, which would be kind of like going and talking to a franchise consultant for someone. But I went and found a career coach and she helped me figure out my strengths and what I was missing out on doing in my life. And that's when I started, I went and got a logo and a business card and called myself a franchise advisor and started what I'm doing now. And I wouldn't turn back, you know, in a million years. I'm thrilled with all the background I've got, but I think it's never too late to make that change. I think there's a lot of people just get really stuck. And I think we have so much opportunity to control our own destiny, and franchising really provides a lot of that opportunity for people. Like, just figure out what you love to do. There's probably a franchise for it.
That's so true. 4,000 franchises in 90 different industries by some count. What's one of the biggest mistakes you made as a young female franchise owner?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I was 25 years old when I opened my first store. And it's funny. I don't realize at the time, I didn't realize how young that is. And I look at pictures of myself and I laugh. And I was 25 and we had an employee working for us, a male employee who was probably in his 50s, which now doesn't seem that much older, but when you're 25, you know. And I think what I did wrong that I would tell people to be careful about was I was trying to, because I was young, I think was part of it, but I was thinking if I create a fun culture where people feel like they want to come to work and have fun, that will make them more loyal and hardworking. Mm. Well, that backfired because trying to create a fun culture, I didn't incorporate elements of accountability and consequences and things like that, that I probably should have. I didn't have that confidence to do that initially until I realized that by trying to create this fun culture, I really just created people who were complacent and not hardworking. So yeah, my advice would be to not, you don't need to go in there like a dictator by any means, but to go in and have accountability systems. People like boundaries, especially frontline workers and you know, entry wage workers are used to kind of having rules and boundaries. So there's nothing wrong with that. I think you can create a fun culture with accountability, which is probably what I should have done.
Okay. Live and learn and then teach.
Yeah, that's right.
You and I are both doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, you've got some good stories as well, right? About what you've learned.
Yeah, one or two. But let me ask you, you mentioned like people that are furloughed, people that might be unhappy with their job anyway. And if they're thinking about franchising, if they're listening to this podcast, mm-hmm. how would they know if the franchise is the right fit for them?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think one of the first things I would tell people to do is to try to figure out what their unique strengths are. I think we don't take the time to stop and do that sometimes. So I would say to figure out first what your strengths are. And there's a real neat way you can do this. And this is something I did when I was trying to figure out what I should do next. And that is to go to people in your network. And that could be anybody from a spouse to a friend, coworker, current coworkers, or anybody in your network. Maybe 5 or 6 people, and ask them, what do you see as my strengths? Mm. It's a really fun exercise. And look for the commonalities.
Depending, for me,
it is. Yeah, it's very scary. And actually, what I'll tell you is the people that I asked that I thought would have the easiest time doing it were the ones that it was the most awkward. So it was actually my sister-in-law who said to me, I see you doing something to help people in franchising. Like while I was a franchisee, she's like, you know a lot about franchising. And I was like, yeah, I don't know. That seems like, I don't know if they really need that. And you know, here I am now. Of course they do need it. People do need it. But so first go to people in your network, figure out what you're good at. You can even do like the Gallup Strengths Finder test. You can buy the book and it's got a code in it. And once you know your strengths, also then, you know, look at the different companies and as you're looking at them, do you have passion? Like I think passion for the brand, passion for the founder, the culture of the company is really, really important because if you don't, getting up every day and having to try to figure out how to make money at something that you're not passionate about is just unrealistic.
Well, I just want to interject. So sometimes people get confused between passion and hobbies. Because, and you know, a lot of people, we all know the term, if you ever heard the phrase, if you love your work, you never work a day in your life.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm persuaded that that is true if you're working a job. But a business is not a job. You're creating a lifestyle. You're creating mm-hmm. equity for yourself. You're buying back time through delegation. So in my opinion, you could be a vegetarian and own McDonald's. But what do you mean by passion?
Yeah, that's a great, I love that you're clarifying that. So you could be a vegetarian and own a McDonald's because you love people or you love systems, right? So what do you have a passion for? And when I was doing this research on myself, I have a passion for people. That's no doubt. I have a passion for bringing people together. I have a passion for teaching. So I could run a carpet cleaning business and still be satisfying those passions. It doesn't mean that you can't, but you do have to get excited. I do believe you have to get excited about the thing that you're doing as well and the purpose behind it as well. So if you look at the company, does the purpose of the company, even if it is a carpet cleaning business, there's still purpose in that and that you're making people's homes, you know, fresh and clean or whatever that is. If that gets you excited, then that could solve that for you.
Absolutely, Angela. I love that. It, you know, at the end of the day, it's really, you know, you don't have to do your hobby, but you have to wake up and be excited about what you're doing and be excited about your vision for the future, because that's what you're creating. And as you know, whether it's a franchise or a business or a job, it's just a vehicle to get you what you want in life.
That's right. And make, yeah, so make that thing, you want to know what you want to get in the longer run, but make sure that what you're doing now is getting you something that gets you excited right now. Like I said, if it's people or if it's something about systems, and, you know, find the thing that gets you really excited and make sure that that franchise that you choose. I mean, there's so many other things to determine if it's a fit. I'm just not even scraping the surface here, but, you know, it's a short podcast. So keeping it, that's the number one thing I would start with is like being passionate. But on that note, I do have a, on my website, there's a, which is angelacote.com. There's an article I wrote about the 5 rockstar questions you should ask when thinking of joining a franchise. And it sort of taps into this as well, like systems to ask, or questions about systems and things like that. It's the rockstar questions because everybody thinks to ask, how much can I make? How much am I going to work? You know, these kinds of questions. The rockstar questions are like above and beyond that.
Right. So it's the questions that people don't know to ask.
That's ideally what it should be. Yeah. That's what I wrote it as.
So it's, Angela Cote, it's Cote.com, right?
Correct, yeah. And my website's going to be getting a new, a big new look soon and rebrand, but it's on there right now if you go to the Ad Scene In page.
Little facelift, I guess, huh?
Oh, yeah. It's time.
Good. So you talk about core values a lot. Why should people be looking for a franchise that know their core values when they're searching for a business?
I love that question. And I think if you're looking for a franchise and you go on their website and they don't have any core values listed, to me, this is in the 5 rockstar questions, actually. To me, that's a little bit of a red flag, because core values help a company be aligned and know what they stand for. And a good company will use the core values for all the decisions they're making. And so actually, before even looking for core values, if you're listening to this and you're thinking of becoming a franchisee, I would highly encourage you to assess what's important to you. So instead of now we're talking not there were the strengths you should know, but what's really important to you. An example of a core value of mine is that we get more done when we're having fun. I won't work with someone. I won't bring anyone on my team if they don't like to have a little bit of fun. Another one is that everything is figure outable. I want to work with people who have a can-do attitude. I stole that from Marie Forleo, if anyone has heard that before. So when you know that, and then so get clear on what's important to you, and then you can go look at what the core values are of the company you're thinking of becoming a franchisee in and see if they match. They don't have to obviously match up perfect, but is there anything in there that, you know, is a concern? And then one of the questions to ask is, you can ask, how do you, at this company, how do you live and breathe your core values? And if they're like, what? We don't even know. Like, right. You know, if those are just on a shelf in the back room, that's also a red flag. Yeah.
That's cool. No one has ever said that on this podcast.
I like being a first.
Yeah, that's brilliant. Cool. Love that. So thank I get totally an aside, totally off track here, but I got to ask. So if you know Marie Forleo, you know Chalene Johnson?
Oh, no, I don't. You're teaching me something here.
All right. So we'll talk offline about it.
Okay. I'll need to know
her. Chalene is awesome. Oh my God. If you like
Marie. Yeah, if I like Marie. Okay.
Oh yeah.
Cool. That's awesome. That is actually one of my secrets too, by the way, is to success is finding those kind of mentors online that motivate you and get you really excited and help you think more clearly. So if anybody hasn't listened to Marie Forleo or Chalene Johnson.
Yeah. Chalene Johnson.
Yeah. I'll have to check her out, but yeah.
She was originally, she did like butt buster butt or something like that videos like in the late 80s.
Oh, okay. Like a workout thing.
It was like a workout thing.
Yeah.
Now she teaches success.
Okay.
And her and her husband are rock stars. They're great. They're so good.
Awesome. I'll check them out.
Your son is doing amazing things now. He's college age. teaching people how to do Snapchat and TikTok and whatever.
Oh, I love it. You know, I love how people are figuring out how to monetize, you know, their these unique skills that they have. If they can figure that out, that's great. That's what I'm doing, actually. Who am I to talk?
Right. And I think everybody does that to an extent, but now it's so much easier. You can learn everything.
Yeah. It's just think about what you know and what you can teach and go out there and do it. And then, and on the flip side, what you don't know, go find it.
Right.
Everything, it's probably there.
As my mother would say, everything is on the internet.
That's cool.
Yeah. It's amazing. So if any, so since we're talking about mentors, any other mentors that you would mention or any books that you've read that you would recommend to?
Yeah, sure. These are the very high profile mentors I would tell people to look out for. Cause I was going to say in my network, Dan Monahan, for example, is one of my mentors in franchising. And I've got a few other really cool people that I've been able to learn from along the way. But in terms of sort of famous people, Ed Milet is a current guy that I'm really loving. It. If you like Marie Forleo, you probably love him too. Ed Milet. And then as far as books, and I love his YouTube videos and podcasts. But as far as books go, one that I would really highly recommend is High Performance Habits by Brendan Burchard. Have you heard of that one?
Oh, sure.
I
read that book.
Cool. What I love about it is it's so action oriented, right? Like it's like, you know, there's little stories to help make it make sense, but then you're reading, you're like, okay, this is what I need to do. And it's also really fun when you're reading and you're going, I do that, which isn't everything in the book, but.
Yeah, Brendan Burchard is awesome.
Yeah, good guy.
Yeah, very good, down to earth. I've attended many of his programs in San Jose, actually.
Oh, very cool. I didn't know that. That's very awesome.
Yeah.
Really. No wonder. That explains a lot.
He's a really good guy.
Cool.
Cool. Any technology hacks that you're using these days?
Ooh, that's fun. One of them that I use a lot with my team, and this is for efficiencies, is an app called Voxer. And it's a voice messaging app. And instead of having to type, I don't know about you, but I'm not a millennial or a Gen Z. So I don't really like typing on a phone and stuff. So I love Voxer. It's really quick. I just go on and I go, you know, hey, Belle, my marketing person. Hey, Belle, I just was on this podcast. It's ready to post, blah, blah, blah. You know, and she just gets the message and off it goes. It's super efficient. There's probably others I'm not thinking of right now, but that's definitely one of my go-tos. Actually, one other cool one is called Brain Toss. I'm just using apps as an example right now. Brain Toss is an app on your phone and you can speak into it and then it sends the message to your email so that, like, if you're driving, you just can tap it and go, you know, hey, send Tom an email. And then it'll just be in my email reminding me to send Tom an email.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Brain toss.
Brain toss. Cool. Writing that down. And what was the first one you had mentioned? I'm sorry.
Voxer. Like boxer, like a boxing match boxer, but a V as in Victor.
Nice. What parting words of advice would you give to someone looking for a franchise right now?
Ooh, right now. I would say, I'm going to back to Marie Forleo. This is a line I heard from her that really helped me stop sitting around and thinking about it and get off my butt and go do something when I needed to make a change in my life. And that is, and you maybe will recognize it, clarity comes from engagement, not thought. So I would highly encourage anybody that's thinking about making that change to take that first step and don't be afraid. You know, just take the first step and see how it feels. Then take the next step and see how it feels. I'm not saying jump off a cliff right into a franchise tomorrow. I'm saying take some kind of action that's going to get you closer to your goals and simplify it. Like, think, what is just one little step I can take? And it's whether that's requesting the franchise kit or reaching out to a franchise consultant like yourself, you know, that can help them find the right franchise or looking at websites. Take the step.
Yeah, so franchise consultants are free.
I know, right?
So it's a great, you know, conversation. And I always say to people, listen, if you talk to me, three things are going to happen. One of three things will happen. You'll figure out franchising is not good for you, and that's fine. Mm-hmm. Two is I'll figure out that you're not a fit, and you have to be okay with hearing that. And third, you might find the perfect franchise and live happily ever after.
Yeah, which of those really sounded all that bad? None, right? Because you got clarity by finding out that maybe you're not a fit for franchising, and now you can move on and go do the thing that you should be doing, right? Or, like, you know, you said, maybe you'll help them find that right franchise, or, you know, whatever it is, they figure it out.
You, me, Marie, and the average guy on the street, where, you know, like, I look at life as like a ping pong. I'm not ping pong, but a pinball machine.
Pinball? So,
where the ball, we're bouncing off the bouncers, and all those bouncers and flippers are people, and they're directing us. And you just need to have a conversation. No harm, no foul. Easy. How could people get in touch with you?
Well, if people want to reach out directly, they're welcome to email me at angela@angelacote.com. So that was C-O-T-E. I'm all over social media, as you know. I think that's kind of how we first connected. Or check out my website, angelacote.com.
Angela, this is great. Thank you so much for being on the Franchise Academy. Information will be, all of Angela's information will be on the franchiseacademy.com, and some highlights of even the people in the books that we talked about. So check it out there, franchiseacademy.com. And Angela, thanks so much for being on the show. You are awesome rock star in franchising.
Oh, thank you. Well, I don't know if you know, but when I always close up my videos, I say, go be awesome. So I'm going to say that now.
Okay.
Go be awesome.
All right. You be awesome. Right back at you. Thanks, Angela.
Yeah, thank you.
Alrighty, bye.
Bye.
This has been another episode of the Franchise Academy Podcast. For more info, go to our website, thefranchiseacademypodcast.com. Remember to subscribe to Tom Scarta's YouTube channel for educational videos on franchising, education, insight, and inspiration.